Ah, Rob Black Show, we're here, we're live, we're going, we're strong. Man, Mondays are always, always a, I don't even know what the fuck up Mondays are. Mondays are just Mondays, how's that? This is the Rob Black Show. I am your host, Roberto Negro. Yes. Roberto Negro. That is what they call me in Spanish, in just straight American terms, English terms. It goes by Rob Black. Sometimes I'm referred to as the Great, kind of like Alexander the Great. They call me Rob the Great. Sometimes I'm referred to as, the list of names go on and on. And yes, I am the creator and maker of everything that is pornography in the last 30, well, not 30 years, at least since 96. Anything before 96 is just kind of shit. The business doesn't really started being cool until I came on the scene in 96. So, it's the Rob Black Show. I'll tell you guys something. Now, today I'm going to have to break format a little, which is kind of disheartening. I'm looking pretty spiffy today, aren't I? Got the nice Tom Byron said I looked a little bright today. It's very bright. I feel bright. I feel festive. I remember we left you last week, and last week's show, or I should say last week's programming, I was making reference to, I think I have a problem of being manic and depressive. Yes, we had this conversation over the weekend when we were on our way back from watching wrestling yesterday, the Elimination Chamber match. And I was making reference to the fact of being, actually I was actually making reference to the fact of being manic depressive Saturday night too, but I explained that over the week of Monday through Friday of last week that I was in a very good mood. I was in a very, very good mood, and I wasn't too sure why I was, considering not much has definitely changed. Nothing was definitely new or evolving, but I was in a very good mood. And I was not exactly sure why, but nonetheless, see, now I'm reading what it means, and they're saying that it means bipolar disorder. I have dramatic mood swings. But I don't have sleeplessness. I don't have hallucinations. I don't have psychosis. I don't have grandiose delusions. Although it says the mood swings can range from very mild to extreme, and they can happen gradually or suddenly within a time frame of minutes to hours. The mood swings happen frequently. The process is called rapid cycling. I don't know. I don't know. Okay, clinical depression symptoms seen with bipolar disorder include decreased appetite and or weight loss or overeating and weight gain. Difficulty concentrating, remembering, making decisions. Fatigue, decreased energy, being slowed down. Nah, feeling of guilt, worthlessness, and helplessness. Nah, really. No guilt. No worthlessness. I think I'm fucking awesome. Helplessness, definitely sometimes. Feelings of, okay, insomnia, early morning awakening, or oversleeping. Not really. Loss of interest or pleasure in hobbies and activities that were once enjoyed, including sex. I've never really had any hobbies. Hobbies have always been work. So, including sex, I don't necessarily think that. I think I just kind of get tired. And now that I'm 40, you know, the whole sex thing, it gets a little, it's like, man, I got to, you know, get it going. Although I had sex twice in the past 3 days, I think, or 4 days. Nothing yesterday, but I think Thursday and Friday. Definitely was back-to-back fuck sessions, dumping loads. So I'm definitely, but nothing yesterday. Definitely nothing yesterday. And I don't think there was any, maybe Saturday. Definitely maybe Saturday. I think it was Friday and Saturday. I think Friday and Saturday I was dumping loads. Not, definitely not yesterday, but I think Saturday. Or maybe not Saturday. Maybe it was Thursday and Friday. Not real sure. But load, shot out my cock. Definitely 2 days in a row, not sure what day it was. Okay, persistent physical symptoms that did not represent treatment, such as headaches, digestive disorders, and chronic pain. Sometimes, I don't know, digestive disorders, what's that, having the shits? Headaches. I don't always have a headache, but persistently sad, anxious, or empty. Moods. Not persistently sad. See, I think all this stuff, I explained this to Katie Summers Saturday night when we were walking around in one of the malls, and we were talking about things like this, and it was kind of funny, because I described all of this as being, you have this when everything in your life is awesome. So, like, you sleep on a bed of roses and gold flakes. You have five or six prostitutes. If you're a woman, you have five or six boys, young men, with the marble bag underwear, where they're just their balls and their cock are just really nice in there. And they're just in perfect physique, and they walk in, and they're like, yes, would you like these grapes and my cock inside your vagina? That type of thing. And you have people that come over every day with just barrelfuls of gold, bullion, and still, after all of that, you feel all of these things. Hopelessness, depression, emptiness, can't sleep, you're slowing down. I told Katie, I said, that's depression. We were having a debate of what depression, I said, that's depression. When you basically have everything that you could possibly want in your life, and life is good, and you feel, shitty and horrible, and you want to die. I go, that's fucking depression. Then you have a problem. But life is pretty shitty as it is, and everything life throws at you is nothing but curveballs, screwballs, fastballs. But every so you get a hanging curveball that you fucking hit out of the park, and then you fucking walk around and do the fucking run around the bases, and everything's beautiful. that is a natural progression of life. So having shitty things happening in your life and also feel like restless and hopeless and slow down and that's normal. So it's hard to say if that's depression, because we've all gone through that. We've all gone through a week or two where every day you get up and you're like, what happened today? Oh, the sink is broke? Fuck! What happened today? Oh, the fucking, the the dog is shit all over the house last night because you didn't take it out, you cocksucker, and left the door open and now there's shit all over you, fuck. Those things happen, you know. You go to the office and your boss is like, hey, that project you did, the clients shit all over your advertising campaign. They think you suck. But I said you were just having a bad day. So here, asshole, do it again. That stuff happens all the time. So it's hard to mix that up. So I got to tell you, I don't think I'm mad. I just cured myself. I don't think I'm manic depressive or bipolar. I don't see it. I think I just let sometimes the world attack me, and then I roll with it. Like I internalize it more, and it's easier to, I think, feel shitty and look at the glass that's half empty than it is to look at the glass that's half full. Because when I'm looking at all this stuff, I don't really see any of this on a complete scale, where it says, what are the signs of mania with bipolar disorder? The signs of mania with bipolar disorder. Disconnected and racing thoughts, grandiose notions, inappropriate irritability, inappropriate social behavior, increased sexual desire, increased talking speed and or volume, marked increased energy, poor judgment, severe insomnia. Severe insomnia. I've never, ever had insomnia. Ever. Ever! So, I'm not manic depressive. I'm not bipolar. It fucking blows. Alright, none of that. So we can't have fun with that no more. And definitely, Katie Summers is not manic depressive either. Or depressed. Katie will go, I feel depressed. I go, why do you feel depressed? I don't know. I don't know. I go, why would you feel depressed? Because you got to take the dog out to go piss. It's a lot. It's 1 a.m. and you got to go all the way fucking 6 flights downstairs to walk outside and it's cold out and you got to take the dog to piss. That's not being depressed. That's just you got to take the dog to go piss. Yeah, you're right. All right, so I've been wanting to pull this up, and I figured I'd pull it up while we were on the air, just because I'm always saying that I think I'm manic depressive. I just like that song by Jimi Hendrix. Manic depressive. That's a good song, but yeah, no, it's not. Ah, oh, god damn it. All right, so there's my manic, depressive, bipolar. I think I'm getting fucking Alzheimer's, though, because I was with a bunch of kids from old XPW days. We went to go see wrestling yesterday at one of the guys' buildings, one of the old referees, and a bunch of the wrestlers were there. And we were watching Elimination Chamber, WWE, and some of the guys are bringing up stories from XPW, and I'm like, I don't remember that. I'm like, I don't fucking. And it wasn't like a, I don't want to remember. It was like, I don't remember that. Like, you don't remember when, you know, all these things happen in this match? I'm like, nope. I go, bro, a lot of shit would go down every day with what we did with XPW. I go, it was a fucking company that rivaled any of the other companies that weren't necessarily WWE at the time. You know, we weren't that big as the WWE, but we were just as big as like an ECW to a degree. You know, we were running a bunch of shows. We had a weekly TV show that was on in a bunch of markets. So we produced television. We had 50, 60, 70 people working for us. I don't remember every goddamn person or everything that ever fucking transpired with what we did. I don't remember what was real. I don't remember what was fake. I don't remember how fake some of the stuff was, how much of an angle we used on other stuff. I don't know. All I do know is the level of success we got to. Nobody else has been able to replicate it as a smaller fed. So now Summers, no, Kate Summers hit me and said we had sex Monday and Thursday. I disagree, Katie. I disagree. There was a time, and it was a double sex session. I know there was a double sex session. I know it. Monday and Thursday. I'm telling you, there was a double sex session, and then I even remembered it because I wanted to space out my cum because I wanted it to be full and powerful, not just dribbling out. I wanted it to explode. But nonetheless, if that's what you'd say, Monday and Thursday, so be it. See, that's not bad, guys. For a 40-year-old man, two times in a week? Come on, man. I probably could have done a third. I'm telling you, Catherine, no. Because we went out. There was a going out at one point that I wanted to dump some magic cum. What the fuck? Don't you remember? You remember. Was it Monday? Maybe I'll have to do another Monday round tonight. Maybe I'll have to fucking pull out the old sausage and fucking bring that shit home. Taking it home. Anyways. So we watched XPW yesterday. Hi, Katie's still hitting me. No, you must have been with your 21-year-old because we had back-to-back snacks. All right. I definitely wasn't with my 21-year-old. I have no 21-year-old. I could no 21-year-old. 21, 24, the same fucking thing. So 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, it's all the same thing. The age doesn't shift until you hit 30. When you hit 30, there's the difference. And when you got a 30-year-old, then you're into the old zone. So what the fuck, man? XPW. We had again, the Elimination Chamber yesterday. We watched the WWE. It was exciting. It was good. It was quite entertaining to see some of the old wrestlers from the XPW era. It was good. It was thoroughly entertaining. We discussed possible moves and things that we were gonna do to get things going again. We're still in the planning stages of the XPW return. We'll go through that later. because I'll go into more depth. Plus, we have a new T-shirt that is being put together. We'll go to the printers today. A new SPW shirt that will be exciting. We have a new channel that will be having XPW product on it. We're putting together a lot of old footage that it has never been aired before. We're in the process of doing that. Just got a lot of things that we're doing, putting together different things with some of the old workers with XPW. So I'll get into that later on in the show. Maybe we'll go over it tonight because I'll have more information later about it, from the T-shirts to one of my guys, one of our legendary wrestlers, White Trash, Johnny Webb, who we were communicating with yesterday, but he has the flu right now. He has the flu, and he said he's dying. Hopefully he doesn't have AIDS. Hopefully he's not full of AIDS, but we were talking yesterday. Yeah, he's got the flu. Said he feels like shit, but we'll see today or tomorrow if he's feeling a little better and if he's going to be down here. Because when he comes down, we're going to time it for part of the show so I can get him on the air and we can have the world see the reigning XPW World Heavyweight Champion, who was the longest reigning champion of XPW. And when we restart the company, it will feature a lot of the guys from the XPW era. When we started the company back in the Reseda Country Club and so forth and so on. So that will be extremely exciting. So I'm trying to reconcile the fact that you guys, when I say you guys, you guys are basically making me, and when I say that, that means I'm going to have to, plunge, kind of like a plunger that has to go into a toilet and seep out the turds. And it kills me because we have a format and a game plan. And those of you who are brand new into the world of the Rob Black Show, and you've never really experienced our excitement and our program, you'll know, you'll know that we have a format. Now let me explain to you. And those of you again who are new, well, we're going to go through this and we'll try to smarten you up, as they would say in the wrestling business. We're going to smarten you up. Okay. We started this program. It's going to be close to our anniversary, which we're all excited for. We're probably going to have a big on-air anniversary party with cake and ribbons and of course a piñata. Why you say a piñata? Well, Katie Summers has never been involved in a piñata setting, and a couple of the times that we've actually gone to places and she's seen piñatas, she said to me, I want a piñata. I want to be able to get a stick, and I want to be able to take that stick and beat the shit out of a paper mache pony or a paper mache horse or a paper mache dog. When I beat it, candy falls out, preferably Mexican candy. You know, the generic, nasty-looking shit that you buy at the fucking flea market for $5 for a fucking bag this big. She says, I've never done that before. I want to experience what it's like to beat the shit out of a piñata. And I said, well, my dear, if it's the last thing I do with my dying breath, I will have a party for you where you will be able to experience a piñata. So what we're going to do on March 31st, which will be a Monday, and that will be the one-year anniversary of the first air date of the Rob Black Show, we're going to have a piñata party. And I'm going to have a piñata hanging right here. And we're going to have Katie Summers up at the office. Maybe she'll wear a bikini top so we can see her young 24-year-old bosoms in the bikini so we don't get in trouble on YouTube or any of these other streaming services that we're on. God knows we've got 3 different fucking cameras in here. Literally, you guys, well, our feed is on like 4 different, we've got a Roku feed, we have a YouTube feed, we've got a Blog Talk feed, and then we've got a Decast feed, which is our own server that goes out to whoever wants the links, which is adultfyi.com. And the robblackshow.com and all points in between. So we got camera here, camera there, phone lines here. It's just crazy. It's just lunacy with all of the feeds that we have. I totally forgot when we're talking about connection speed. If you think about it, this feed is going, so this is online. Bandwidth and taken from the internet. This cocksucker's online, taken from the internet. That cocksucker's online, taken from the internet. And Tom Byron's computer's in the other room taking on the internet. So it's just, I totally forgot that. Fuck, man. It's like a constant barrage of bandwidth that's pumping out of this building. And it still looks good. Like, the stuff still looks good. It's not all, like, doing the fucking robot. So that's kind of cool. Anyways, we'll have the piñata. Katie will beat the fuck out of the piñata. Candy will fall. And we'll all eat the candy. Maybe I'll get a couple of the Mexicans from the street to join us. Oh, I see, Katie Summers. She said she's from Texas and she's been to 10,000 parties with piñatas. We even had them at school events. I didn't know Katie Summers hung out with Mexicans in Texas and played with piñatas. I thought she only hung out with the racist hillbillies listening to the David Allan Coe songs and and all that, talking about nigger, nigger, nigger stuff. I'm sorry, Katie Summers. I retort. She has been part of the pinata festivities, so my apologies. She wasn't always just into the racist stuff when she told us. And none of you were privy. If you are new to the show, you weren't privy to the conversations that we had last week about racist music. And Katie Summers informed us that while she was in Texas, her and her friends would listen to Johnny Rebel. They would listen to Johnny Rebel songs. And if any of you don't know what Johnny Rebel, what Johnny Rebel is, not to belate the point, but Johnny Rebel is this. Let me just play this for you. This is Johnny Rebel. This is what Katie Summers would listen to with their friends.
The house next door to me has been sold to niggers. They claim to be wild Indians from the plains. Oh, but they ain't a shockingly their color people. We'll make cowboys and niggers our new game.
Alright, so.
Last night.
Now, Katie Summers informed us last week, it's very, very interesting, that her and her friends would play drinking games to Johnny Rebel. So, A, they would play the music, and they would have shot glasses filled with booze, moonshine probably, and every time the word nigger came on, they would have to take a shot. And, so if they had a song that had Johnny Rebel saying nigger like 10 times, they have to take 10 fucking shots. And then she informed us after they were good and loaded, they would get in their pickup trucks, drive around Texas, and look for some black people to lynch up and hang from the trees and, you know, lynch them. So, again, Katie Summers, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I was under the impression that you never engaged in pinata parties. Because we were informed by you that it was strictly Johnny Rebel nigger drinking game parties that you were involved in. We're very sorry. We'd like to take that back. And Katie Summers, if you would please accept our sincerest apologies. And I did not mean to desecrate your childhood whatsoever. Please forgive me. I was wrong with you. And I hope you could forgive me. I hope you could love me forever. And I hope that we can just give peace a chance and me and you can still just get along. Anyways, it's the Rob Black Show. And so when the pinata comes, we're going to hopefully grab a couple of the old Mexicans from the street down there. You think I'm fucking joking? I ain't joking. Probably bring up two or three of them, because you can't have a pinata party with just Katie Summers blindfolded with a bikini top on, you know, because she, trust me, I know her. She'll peek through one slit and start fucking whacking me with the stick, whacking Tom Byron with the stick. It'll be horrible. It'll be a complete disaster. So I'm going to have Katie up here with the blindfold. I'll get some other Mexicans. Maybe we'll get some Mexican girls from the business. It'll just be a whole pinata fest. They'll beat the shit out of the fucking pinata. The candy will fall out. They'll eat the candy. It'll be a big fucking party. So that's going to be coming up on March 31st. Now, I don't want to digress, but when we started this program and I explained to y'all what we were doing, and the premise was pretty simple. And that was to capture the world's imagination, capture the industry's attention, and take this program and parlay everything that we did into something much bigger. From day one, our aspirations and goals were never to be a blog for the porn business until we were 70 years old. It was never our intention to be some type of Harvey Milk and an activist for the people in the adult business. It was never our intention to sit here and create some elaborate union or some elaborate think tank. And never, ever was it to do any of that stuff. It was all a work. In work terms, means wrestling fake. It was fake. When we raided the AVN offices a decade ago, and we had a bunch of people in the inside of AVN involved, and the game plan was to go there and create a disturbance and then have the police show up and arrest me. And we would film it, and we would put it on XPW TV as part of a separate bit of me losing my mind, and it played into where we were going with our television episode. So we used the AVN and Paul Fischbein as our backdrop, and we actually went and rented a real police car, and we had a couple guys that dressed up as police officers, and it was kind of funny because somebody actually said that they knew there was something weird when they noticed that one of the police officers were wearing a pair of Air Jordans, and they didn't say anything, but that's when they thought there was something up with what was going on. But at that point, Paul Fischbein actually hired private security because he was actually afraid of his life. He was. He thought, well, I was going to come back there and blow up his building and kill him and all sorts of weird stuff. And it was all stemmed out of a fake police outing that we came up with that Gene Ross was part of, and Gene Ross wrote the story about how I assaulted a plant. And at that point, Paul Fischbein realized that he had just been had, he had just been, as what we would say, worked. And him hiring professional bodyguards and extra security was wound up making him look incredibly retarded and silly, because as somebody that was a fan of professional wrestling, he realized that he had just been worked. I was the master of the work, from things that people would think were real were not real, things that people thought were fake were not fake. I kept people on their toes constantly. And at the end of the day, it was all for a simple thing, and that was to promote and make what we were doing bigger and better, and in turn generate more revenue for the company. Now, I started this journey into our radio feeds, our radio broadcasts, our editorial staff, Tom Byron, and our movie making, and whatever we did when we started this was strictly based on how do we take 15 years of Rob Black, or I should say 20 years of Rob Black in the business, and taking stories, taking this personality, larger than life, everything that we did, and how do we parlay that into real money, not porn money, But we're talking about real money. We're talking about, you know, TV shows. We're talking about books. We're talking about an entertainment conglomerate that, as you see, what the WWE did, what Vince McMahon did by creating his own channel, is poised to bypass network televisions, Comcast, Time Warner, and he's a publicly traded company. That ultimately was the goal of this program and everything that we did and how we were going to succeed and get bigger than anything could ever be, because at the end of the day, we all knew the writing was on the wall, unlike the rest of the porn business, with content and the fact that pornography is offered for free. And the way pornography is and the way the sex business is, people don't fucking care who the girl is, who the asshole is, who the vagina is. They want to get off. They want to masturbate. And that's it. The way the medium is now, when somebody wants to jerk off, it's not a matter of going to a video store and renting a DVD and going home and put. They go on to any free website that is on the internet, and they just find something that's going to get them off. Rather it's a pregnant chick, rather it's gay anal fisting, rather it's lesbian, whatever the fuck they get off on, you can find it for free on the internet. And unless you're a conglomerate in the sense of a Manwin, unless you're a Vivid, unless you're somebody, a hustler, that is worth millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars, that has tens of thousands of videos of content, and has a position to lay out millions of dollars for networks that come along with traffic sources. Katie's hitting me. On a side note, says that's all we had in school were Mexicans. I was forced to hit damn piñatas. And when I mean parties, I mean birthday parties when I was a little kid. So the little kid in piñatas, were that was all Katie's younger era. Well, Katie Summers, on March 31st, my love, you're going to be hitting piñatas again, baby. So don't forget that. So unless you're... unless you're any of these things that amount to unless these people are investing in traffic hubs. And when I say that, meaning this. Anybody in porn can put together a internet channel. Anybody in porn can put together something to be accessed on the internet. But the key is to get, as the old word is, traffic. And unless you can get real traffic, and I ain't even talking about hundreds of thousands of people a month, because you have to put it in terms of a return rate of what, 2%, 1%, 3%. If you're hitting a 3% return on your traffic, and what that means is, you know, for every fucking amount of people that come to your site, you're getting at least 1%, 2%, 3% of them to buy something. And when I use these numbers, they sound low, but they are exactly in par with what our business does. Your conversion ratio, all of these things. So if you got a traffic source of, you know, 300,000 a month, and you're getting 2% return, and you're buying something, you ain't gonna make a fucking empire on that. You're not gonna, you know, and it's gonna take you an astronomical amount of time to do anything of substance. So unless you're somebody that can actually generate millions and millions of people a month going to a site, and then you are pumping content on there that is fresh and brand new that nobody's seen, and those people specifically want to see that fresh and new content, you're done. You're fucking done. And most everybody in this business, at one time or another, has either sold their content or done something with somebody that will make your videos available for free. Now, I could go on many, many tube sites and watch Evil Angel content for free. I can watch Elegant Angel content for free. Now, rather they are in cahoots with these certain tube sites, or the tube sites are just putting their stuff up, it really doesn't matter, because it's there. It's there, which gives you no incentive to necessarily buy the DVD. And if you look at Hollywood DVD business, and you look at where the Hollywood DVD business is, and the amount of product that Hollywood now has on streaming services that go directly to the online companies, whether it's an Amazon or a Redbox, versus how many of those DVDs are available in the buying market, you're looking at 8-to-1, 9-to-1. And if Hollywood had to survive on DVD sales, they wouldn't be able to. So if Hollywood is making this huge transformation, and people like Vince McMahon, WWE, publicly traded company, are making this huge transformation, and Amazon.com is making programming that is not available on DVD, it's not available on network television, and you can only see it on Amazon.com, how do you look at the adult business and look at the model that the adult business is doing and think for 1 second this is a viable business opportunity? It's not. So when we started the transformation in March 31st, I knew that we had to captivate the industry. We had to basically suck them in and captivate them with something that wasn't Cock Smokers 38, Southern Book Hockey. Gives a fuck. Nobody fucking cares. And it's painfully obvious that nobody fucking cares now, because everybody's fucking broke. Nobody's got no fucking money. And the only thing this business is, once again, and I will reiterate, is a bunch of people, and in essence, that are making lower to middle class money in the sex trade. And for them, it beats getting a 9-to-5 job at Home Depot, or getting a job at a bank cleaning toilets, or something of that nature. but the visions of being rich are gone. Unless you're an established giant that's been around for 30 years. Unless you're a player who's been doing this. And if you take a look at the people that are in this business that are surviving, that's exactly who they are. Any of the companies that are coming out of Canada, so to speak. And what I mean by that, the company over there that has Mason, the Hard X, that is done by the Canadian guys, Ted Blitt, John Blitt. They are from Canada. They made their money buying people's foreign rights here. So they would buy a movie. They buy a production that we all would make for $20,000, $30,000, or $40,000, and they would buy the movie for say $4,000. Some companies only would get $1,500, $1,000, and in turn they would sell that and make, I don't know, 10 times their money back on it. Ted Blitt literally would buy a movie from us for $4,000, package it, put it through the Canadian boards so they could approve it, because that's how it worked in Canada, and then sell 1,000 pieces in all of Canada for, say, $20, $25. Maybe they'd sell 1,500 pieces. Maybe they'd sell 2,000. But they would literally make 5-6 times what they could make, and they owned the rights in Canada. And they own the rights for video on demand in Canada. And trust me, somehow all of these rights got muddied up and infiltrated back into the States. And what I mean by that is they would put your scenes in comps that would sell back into the United States. And they would tell you that there was no clauses in the contract about compilation rights. It was all fucking mumbo-jumbo bullshit. But at the end of the day, guess what? They are the ones that are thriving. Hard X, Mile High, it's all part of the same group. They're from Canada. They're not even an American company, you morons. They're not an American company, you stupid fucks. So there's one of the big players that are still producing content, and they're not even from America. Why are they in that position? Because they've been doing it for 20 years, 30 years. Hustler, the library, and they have their own satellite. We've gone through all of this. So we came up with a plan, and that was going to be any way possible to create a buzz on what we were doing. It was a genius plan. And right from the gate, we got our first press with the Daily Beast, the Daily Beast. And from the Daily Beast, it went to the Young Turks. And it was Porn's Whistleblower, talking about porn and yada, yada, yada. And then it morphed into the condom debate and the things with Isadora Hall and Cameron Bay, which we were responsible for. All of these things. But ultimately, we had no intentions of ever creating anything of an assemblance of a coalition to rally and get people together and create some fantasy world that all the porn people could come together and sing Kumbaya, and it would never happen. I knew it would never happen because I've been part of the system all my life. And from day one, the system that we have has always been what it is. It's run by complete and utter scumbags. Some of those scumbags are still around and will never ever change. Example, say 20 years ago, 25 years ago, the business would get together, the industry leaders, Russ Hampshire, Lenny Freelander, Stephen Hirsch, what's his name, Elliot from Western Visuals, a lot of these big players. And so everybody would get together and say, all right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to raise our prices, and we're going to not sell our new releases for less than, say, $18. And we're not going to. So everybody would come up with a set of rules. And guess what would happen? Within a day, maybe, each one of these guys would then call certain distributors and say, hey, I know you heard about this big meeting. I know you heard about this. Here's what I'm going to do. This doesn't apply to you because we go way back. So I'm still going to give you a $13 price, but you can't tell nobody. And guess what? Every single one of these industry leaders would all do the same thing. And all the distributors would sit back, laugh their asses off, and one by one, each industry leader would call them and say, I'm going to do this for you, but shh, don't say anything. That, ladies and gentlemen, is how it has always been. No different than in the early 90s when the industry went all condom. And Russ Hampshire and Steve Hirsch and Mike Orenstein, everybody had this meeting at a, I even think it was at the Sportsman's Lodge, where they had all the dead viewings, but I could be mistaken. Anyways, it happened then. When everybody went condom, everybody simultaneously went condom. And in a matter of 2 months, everybody abandoned that philosophy except for Steve Orenstein. And Steve Orenstein stayed condom. Now, Steve Orenstein will make you believe that he just had this great moral fabric, he had this great, but that was bullshit, because Steve Orenstein was nothing more than a Ruby Godsman, Lenny Freelander front. Lenny Freelander gave Steve Orenstein money to start Wicked. Ruby Godsman was involved. All these people were involved. And Steve Orenstein was making movies just like everybody else was, and they were horrible, and nobody wanted them, because if you wanted a good quality feature company, you went with VCA and you went with Vivid. Wicked was nothing more than a joke that was owned by a salesman. So the condom issue gave Steve Orenstein separation. It enabled him to actually now have what would be known as a marketing strategy. It was known to have a advantage because now he could own a category. He could own a situation. And let me explain this to you guys. There's a company in Europe. I think it's France, and they only take condom movies, and they pay big money for the condom movies, and that was the basis of what has kept Wicked surviving for all of these years. And of course, now recently it's been the Manwin connection, which nobody really talks about, but Manwin is part of Wicked. Manwin owns a piece, if not all, but we do know Manwin owns a piece of Wicked, and that piece is their internet division. So Wicked was never a righteous company. They were a company that needed an advantage, and at the time, everybody abandoned the condom situations, and Orenstein said, fuck it. we're in it, let's fucking own it, and eventually, hopefully, it will work. What do I got to lose? Lenny Freelander's backing me, Ruby Gosman, all these old-timers. The worst that could happen is it fails and I go be a salesman again. Big deal. That's what I was before. It's not like I took my life savings and created a company and went out on a limb. I'm a fucking jerk-off salesman for Ruby Gosman and sucked the dick of Lenny Freelander and all these guys. They're going to put me in business? Fuck it. If it works, it works. When everybody abandoned the condom issues, they said, fuck it, roll with it. And it paid off. And here, Ornstein is today still surviving. And when the entire business is in a condom mess, as far as, fuck the disease, who gives a fuck? Do any of you really think any of these owners and any of these people give a fuck that any of the talent get fucking AIDS or get gonorrhea or get syphilis? Nobody gives a fuck. Nobody fucking cares. All the big debate that's going around now is strictly based off of companies getting fined and or getting in trouble from Cal OSHA. Nobody's given a fuck if talent got AIDS before, and nobody gives a fuck now. Cares. Fucking talent are disposable. Talent is a dime a dozen. Dime a dozen. And all of the owners, all of the production companies know that all of your talent will be here to the bitter end. Because anybody who gets into the adult business gets into it because they have no real future in anything else. And porn is their fucking last stop of life because they don't want to work in a fast food restaurant. They don't want to work as a secretary. They don't want to do any of this crap. So in turn, they will continue to basically play the game. This business has always been what it has been from day one to now. I mean, what goes on in our business now is what went on in the 80s, except in the 80s it was more private. In the 80s it was more private. Everything that goes on now is what happened in the 90s. You had disease left and right. You had people with gonorrhea. You had people with fucking syphilis. You had people with everything, except nobody knew about it because there was no Twitters, there was no real internet presence, you had one testing facility, all of these things were around then, all these worker safety issues were around then. Just nobody fucking, it is what it is, and it's never going to change. Just the business itself, think about what you're arguing. Think about what people are arguing when you look at message boards or you look at people's concerns. Nobody cares. People are arguing, oh, everybody should be safe on set. Well, who cares? You're talking about sex. You're talking about people that randomly fuck other people for money. Now all of a sudden there's this safety issue. How do you figure? How many girls show up that have never worked with a guy before? They show up out of the blue, meet a guy, take their clothes off, open their assholes up, and a guy fucks them in the ass. That's how it's always been for 30 years. What now is different? Oh, we need safety. Fucking cares. I told you, this business has been run like this, and it will always run like this. You know, people just didn't like the fact that I pointed this stuff out on a national spectrum. I pointed this out to the media, and now that the media, and now that you have websites and Twitters and Pinterest and Instagrams and all this crap, it gets out there more, and it's more you could see it more, you could smell it more, you could feel it more. Unlike the 90s, unlike the 80s when everything was just quiet. Nobody fucking talked about it. Nobody talked about privates because it was private. Nobody had... Listen, I seen a report today that was on one of the sites we'll get to in Salon where they do a report on girls being hookers in the porn business. So basically, this notion that our business likes to present, Nina Hartley and the Porn Performers 101, and whenever there's a disease that comes up and people blame the outside activity, this report that has interviews from Derek Hay and all of these people basically state that every porn performer is a hooker. So this whole story throws a monkey wrench into everybody in our business, the establishment, say, well, the business gets disease from the outside work, and it's very few of the girls that do outside work. Well, how do you figure when there's a report that has interviews conducted by the players of the business, and they're talking about, what was it on? I think it was on XBiz, not ABN. And they're reporting that everybody's a hooker. So I think it kind of throws a monster monkey wrench in the fact of the porn business not having an escorting mentality, because it does. It's how it always is. You're talking about sex for money, rather it's on film or it's in the personal life. Because remember, what's the difference if a girl shows up and will suck your dick for $150 to $200 and you have a cell phone camera and this is your content and this is how you're making the movie? How is this different than that? There's no difference. There's absolutely no difference. And the girls know that. The girls do it. The girls know, and if any girl who tries to give you the illusion or the telling you that they're not a hooker, they're just ashamed of who they are, and they don't want to admit that when they were in high school and the people said, you're going to amount to nothing but a street hooker, and they went, no, I'm not. I'm going to be the first woman president of the United States. And they're fucking sucking dick. And they go, I'm not a hooker. I'm an actress. No, you're a fucking hooker. Embrace being a hooker. The world needs hookers. And our business needs girls that will suck dick for money. And that's the way it works. Sorry. Sorry. So when we conducted the Rob Black Show, when we conducted all of our businesses and how we were going to do this, it was strictly to captivate the entire world. And that was it. And get people to listen to us, get people to read the sites, get people to buy what we were offering. And what we were offering was entertainment. I could give two shits about any of the fucking talent. I give two fucks. When somebody calls up and says, well, who gives a fuck? You know, our goal was to create havoc. That was it. I mean, that was really it, was to create havoc. And everything that has been going on in the business, as far as legislation, as far as companies going out on a limb and skating rule everything. That it, from Derek Hay getting ostracized to Las Vegas, everything that's happened is because of us. Think about all of the stories that come and go in this business because of us. You will get a fringe player that will talk about it, and nobody gives a fuck. And then we get a hold of it, and then we really blow it up, and then we make it into something that is on a national scale that gets everybody to talk about it. And then in turn, it changes the way people have to do business. That's us. We did exactly what we wanted to do, which was invoke pure havoc in the business. And we've done it, and we've continued to do it, and we're going to do it even more. That was the goal. That was the goal. And I said this before, and I felt like I had to address this again, because sometimes I think you all forget the exact reasoning behind what we have done. Because if you think that our notion was, oh, we're going to make movies, and we're going to make hundreds of thousands of dollars making movies, and we're going to ride this into the sunset, you're out of your fucking minds. When I got out of prison, there was about this much, a fragment of the business left. And that fragment of the business, we took by the horns, and we conquered it. We created a company for fat fuck Jerry Estrada that put him on the map. No denying it. It's called Extreme Comics. Jerry Estrada was put on the map. Howard Levine at Exile Entertainment. As soon as he left Vivid, he had nothing. Started Exile Entertainment with Jerry Estrada. We put him on the map with a movie called Taxi Driver. These are undeniable claims. And as the business went forward, people like Axel Braun made epic movie called Star Wars, captivated the entire fucking porn world and mainstream world. Tom Byron was Obi-Wan Kenobi, captivated, won an award for it. These are the things that we did. All of the business was at the tail end, and we knew that time was running out. And unless there was a monumental shift, there would be nothing left. And I remember sitting there with Tom Byron, and I said, I'll be damned if I'm going to wind up. I go, I know I joke about it, motherfucker. I go, but I'll be damned if I'm going to wind up like Ron Sullivan, or I'm going to end up like any of these either dead or old fucking porn guys that are fucking making $800 to direct a fucking movie. I'm damned if I'm going to be Mitch Spinelli. Fuck. I go, dude, I go, it ain't going to happen. I go, now I've got to parlay what I've accomplished throughout these 20 years and that talent that I've always had, which is entertaining. And Tom Byron looked at me and he said, you think I want to be a fucking fucking Herschel Savage? You think I want to be a fucking Ron Jeremy? You think I want to be 52 years old fucking girls? And not fucking girls once in a blue moon just to get my rocks off and being in some, you know, whatever fucking movie for Axel Braun where I can fucking be on set and get paid $1,000 a day as Obi-Wan Kenobi? No. He goes, I'm talking about, like, doing gonzo scenes, doing fucking blow bangs, being a fucking drool. Because you think I want to fucking do that? He goes, no fucking way. He goes, in a million years, I don't want to be an old guy in porn. He goes, there's nothing worse than being a fucking old guy in porn. because there's absolutely nothing worse. There's nothing more humiliating than being an old guy in porn. And so we embarked on a strategy, and I said, well, I got an idea, and I know how we're going to shake things up. And I know how we're going to have all eyes on us. And so we did it. And we got together with Gene Ross, one of our old partners in crime. And we single-handedly restructured the way this business looked at the internet. And the way they looked at gossip sites. And the way they looked at what was going on with legislation and what was going on with the people that they thought were something important. And in almost less than a year's time, we have managed to work every single person. Literally work every single person. I don't get any of the emails and calls from people wanting me to try to solve this problem anymore, that, because these people who listen to our show know that I don't give a fuck and that I worked them. And we all worked them. Our little group worked everybody. We pulled off the Lufthansa heist on the entire business. I remember when I sat there at the last show I went to, where we won best packaging for Birds of Prey. And I told Mark Spiegler's little fucking partner, George, I said, yo, bro, I go, I'm going to wreak so much fucking havoc on you and your boy Mark Spiegler's life and the entire agents. You guys aren't even going to know what's going to fucking hit you, bro. I'm going to invoke so much fucking drama. I go, you motherfuckers will bow to me. And what did we do? Derek A. fled this motherfucking state, got his ass thrown out of the Vivid building. Thrown out of the Vivid building. And when we told you all he got thrown out, we were told that we were liars. But proof was in the pudding about 3 weeks later, and people went, yeah, he got thrown out of the Vivid building. We basically have done what we wanted to do, and we continue to do what we want to do. We call the fucking shots. We do whatever the fuck we want to do. And there ain't a motherfucker that can dispute or say different. We take you, we gobble you up, and we spit you out or we shit you out. That's what we do, and we do it on a daily basis. And when we started with Gene Ross and we announced to everybody that Gene Ross was retiring, we informed everybody, and Tom Byron even wrote a nice little story about him taking over the writing duties, and he would be writing all of the stories for Adult FYI. And we informed everybody that we would no longer be posting press releases. We informed everybody that we would no longer be cutting pasting bullshit stories about hookers that were in trouble for blowing people in cop cars. And that we would be working on books and we would be working on comedy routines. And subsequently, what have we done? We've published two books, Extreme Thoughts by Rob Black and Don't Drink the Kool-Aid by Rob Black, a collection of over 70 original stories compiled from here. That's what, and those are mainstream stories. Right now, we're working on compiling the porn edition. That's nothing but porn stories, which is about another 70. Again, that's what we do. When you hear us talking about Pilato Entertainment, you can go there right now. He manages the old fart band Asia, Meatloaf, people like that. What do you think? We're blowing these guys? What do you think? We're just name dropping for the sake of name dropping? We wouldn't be name dropping people's names if they weren't part of us, if they weren't involved in putting together different events for us. When you look at Peter Young at Sovereign Talent, and we've got his logo on our sites, and we're talking about him, what do you, just some random agent that we pick up out of the sky, you morons? This is all mainstream people. This is all people that are working on a mainstream avenue for us. That's what our goal was from the beginning. Nothing more, nothing less. The porn industry, we took you, we worked you, and we continue to work you. And that's what we do. We work you. You are our puppets. And we mold you, and we contort you, and we twist you however we want. And if we want to talk about one person and get heat on that person that day, that's what we do. If we want to fuck with somebody another day, that's what we do. If we want to fucking make somebody popular, that's what we do. The entire porn community listens to us, watches us, and we call the shots. And we will continue to do that. So, again, you as the people that never understood or are just new to the show have now been fully indoctrinated into what we do and what we are. And if you've noticed, in the last 2 months, we've only spent the last half hour to 45 minutes on our shows talking about porn. A lot of you are going, yeah, Rob, why are you starting with the porn talk today? Well, exactly, because I was drawn into it in a way that if I didn't start out with it, it would have been on my mind for a whole long time. So I had to give a early history of, again, this program, from Tom Byron to Rob Black, to Katie Summers, to White Trash Johnny Webb, to people that are involved in this program and what we do. And then I can explain to everybody why we started our show with porn. Again, porn is so last half hour of the program. Now, if there's something entertaining to talk about and we want to dictate, rather it's making somebody popular, making somebody famous, or making somebody the evil villain, then that's what we do. Now, we haven't wanted to do that because when we're dealing with the mainstream people, they don't want me to talk about porn all day. When I'm auditioning and Bruce tells me I have to send a tape, or he tells me people are going to be listening to the show, or Peter tells me people are going to be reading the book, I have to not talk about porn all day. They don't want to hear. They want to hear about politics. They want to hear about my life. They want to hear about prison stories. They want to hear things that don't involve somebody with syphilis. And I said, okay. And they want to see if I can do that for 5 hours. And not just for an hour, and I got to talk about pedophiles in the porn business for 2 hours. And things like that. So we geared it up where people could listen to the show and say, this isn't a porn program. This is a variety show that has guests, and they play funny bits, and they play viewer emails, and they do things like that. and he started doing song parodies. We actually got some song parodies by Katie Summers coming up, and she's got videos that she's creating where she's playing different characters, but are pretty fun. And that's, in a nutshell, what these people want to see. And that is what is hopefully propelling us to get on and get with a couple of these producers. So on the off chance that we engage in a day of porn or a half day of porn, I always want to make sure that it's something important. And I've made jokes about it, but AIDS is always a great thing. Lawsuits are always a great thing. Anything that is involving people that could either kill them, that could either ruin their careers or their business, are always big winners in the conversation piece, because we can have fun with that. Someone's got AIDS, we can have fun with that. Somebody's got cancer and they're dying, we can have fun with that. But if somebody's just talking shit on somebody or doing a radio show, there's really no fun to that. And we'll just pass it through in the porn stories of the day. So if you go to Adult FYI, which is the website that we will write and do things for. Tom Byron will put together porn stories and so forth and so on. Now, the funny thing is, we used to put all of our different shows, right? And so Tommy would do stories. And every day he does two stories, three stories, and he writes for the books. And he would do a piece on different people. So he'll listen to the show, and then he picks out entertaining aspects of the goddamn show. And example, I'll give you an example. The new story that he has is entitled Nazis Ruin Everything. And that is a part of our show that we did, I think, a week ago. And it talks about a article that I read one night that is a camp or a resort in Germany that was used during the Nazi era. And they want to now make the resort into they want to make this camp into a resort. And some people were complaining about it and so forth and so on. And so I did a bit about how the Nazis ruined everything. They got great slogans like Idiot Mach Frei. I know I said that wrong, but it means work will set you free. That's a great slogan. If I was the boss of a company and I said, work will set you free, guys, that's a great, great slogan. Harder you work, the money you're going to make, the more productive you'll be. You can retire, own your own business. You'll have the resources to control your own destiny, be your own boss. But because it was used on top of Auschwitz, it's looked down on to say work will set you free. And we also talked about the mustache and the fact that Hitler completely ruined that badass mustache. And you had Charlie Chaplin and Hitler. And so that is a story that we have, and Tom Byron did it. It's a great story. We have a Ted Nugent story that we did from Friday. Now, these stories we don't post on Adult FYI. They go into the book. They go into the mainstream aspects of the show. They don't go on Adult FYI. Adult FYI has one porn story a day. That's it. And we have videos up. We have show episodes up. We have all of these things up that are there for your entertainment. But as far as the stories go, you have to go to Amazon.com and buy one of the books. And very soon you will be able to go to the website and become a member, and you can read a lot, or I should say all of these stories. So this is what we do. Now, Friday's story, which was incredibly entertaining, and it was called McLovin Loses His Museum and Rob Black Got Mike South Fired from Elegant Angel. And let me give you a little funny, entertaining history on this. At the end of the show, we read all of the porn news rundowns. And I go to AVN, I go to XPiz, and then I go to Mike South, because those three are the Bibles of what happens in our business. And the first story that caught my eye, and I couldn't talk about anything else because it was too funny, was a museum in Las Vegas that talked about their artifacts, and it talks about their business and how they have basically these precious heirlooms. Basically, they kind of have, if it was back in, you know, the Nazi era, they have art that the Nazis would have stolen and taken for themselves. Pictures of Mark Wallace full of AIDS, Tony Montana full of AIDS, John Stagliano full of AIDS, you know, just great things like that. So we did this story, and I did a bit where Tom Byron put it into a story. And then at the end of the routine, we talked about Mike South. And we went to his site, and the fact that the guy is talking about Evil Angel and talking about their violations that they got, and that it's this giant deal. But when you go to Mike South's site, the Evil Angel violations don't exist because the link doesn't work. And the fact that he then tried to say that the link worked, but it never worked. He was wrong. He was ignorant. He's stupid. Just like once this became known, and the fact that he kept trying to push these Evil Angel theory of all their violations, he then actually started to post that there was this cover-up going on, and that somebody had them removed, had the violations removed from the Cal OSHA sites. I mean, the guy just stretches and reaches for so much shit because he's just a lying, nobody hillbilly that's never accomplished anything in his entire porn life. And we mention that. And it's quite comical how we mention it. And again, when people started questioning where all of these reports were that Mike South is talking about, Mike South starts talking about, again, that lawyers and people started going into Cal OSHA, and they had they pulled out these disappearing records, and he's gonna fucking find out what happened. And so as the entire business laughs, because again, this is a guy that is a complete retard, and he's completely delusional that he does anything. I made reference to the fact that he is such a loser that I got his ass fired when we were at Elegant Angel. Literally, I got his ass fired. All right? And I told the story of Mike South getting shit-canned from Elegant Angel. Now, a lot of you don't know these stories because people like Mike South try to rewrite history. And they can't. But they try to. But I'm always there to make sure everybody knows the facts. And again, this business doesn't like the facts because they actually have to look at themselves in the mirror and realize that they're either losers or they got to realize that they were fucking no one who ever would amount to anything. And these are all facts. And so I explain the story about, and you can read it on adultfyi.com right now, and I'll kind of give you a rundown on it again. When, and here's the story. When we all came to Elegant Angel, what happened was Patrick Collins was with John Stagliano at Evil Angel. Patrick Collins was John Stagliano's sales manager. He was like the top dog. And he had a company called Elegant Angel under the banner of Evil Angel. And John Stagliano and Patrick Collins got into a beef, and Patrick Collins left John Stagliano. And this is when they were in Van Nuys, and he basically moved across the street on Covello and moved into a unit across the street. And the only person he had was a guy by the name of Ken DeLucia, who had a favorite saying called "Living a Dream," and the guy was just a horrible, horrible general manager. And he had a kid by the name of Nick Starks, who was Patrick's art guy at the time, that who was going to work and help him. And that's all Patrick had. And he had a man by the name of Miles, who was the bookkeeper, warehouse guy. And that was the company. And so what happened was Greg Alves was running a company called Highline, and it was a bookstore in San Diego. And he is now the general manager, runner of a company called Zero Tolerance, a third degree, and the rubber company, the toy company. I think they're called Evolve. I think that's what it is. And so Greg, at the time, knew that Patrick would be looking for directors because it was big news that Patrick had left Evil Angel. So Greg sent up Patrick videos that he had produced. Now, at the time, Greg Alves had a partner named Van Damage. And him and Van Damage made amateur movies. So it was called VG Entertainment, Van and Greg Entertainment. And so VG Entertainment set up Patrick Collins' videos. And Van Damage would go out and shoot the videos and edit them, and Greg Alves would market them and sell them. So Patrick Collins liked the videos, and they were amateur videos. Van was good at amateur talent, getting amateur talent. So Greg Alves drove up from San Diego to meet with Patrick Collins because Patrick wanted to meet him about giving him a production deal. So in the midst of their conversation, and Greg Alves is a really nice guy, believe it or not, and he's a big, 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 tall, oafy guy who was extremely nice, he's charming, he was funny, and he basically told Patrick, you want my videos? They're awesome. And Pat said, yeah, you just got shitty boxes and, you know, you need some direction. And Greg said, well, Patrick Collins, you've got a great company, but you have a loser general manager in the name of Ken DeLucia, and you need somebody to actually put your shit together, because you could be the biggest thing in the business because you're from Evil Angel. So Greg and Patrick struck a deal, and Patrick brought Greg Elves in to be the general manager and to basically run that company. And the deal was, Patrick paid Greg Elves $10,000 a movie. So he had a production budget of $12,000, and then he got $10,000 on top of it just for a fee. And he took $5,000 and he gave Van Damage $5,000. And that was the deal. So Greg Elves was the boss of Elegant Angel. Then subsequently, Greg Elves was the person that would bring talent in. Greg Elves brought me in. Tom Byron was already with Patrick Collins, because right before Greg got there, Tom Byron went and met with Patrick, and Patrick gave him a directing job, and he was paying Tom Byron $5,000 a movie. Now, when Greg Elves hired Rob Black, I wouldn't do nothing for less than $10,000 a movie. And I had to have $15,000 budgets, and I had to basically have carte blanche on what I was doing. Yes, it was very arrogant for somebody who had never, or who had only done two movies for VCA, but I knew how to negotiate. So Greg Elves hired me. So I made $10,000 a movie, Tom Byron made $5,000 a movie, and Van Damage made $5,000 a movie, and Greg Elves got $5,000 of that. Now, over the time, all three of us became closer and closer friends, and we negotiated that Tom Byron would get $10,000 a movie. So Tom Byron got his pay up to $10,000. And when this happened, Van Damage was very disgruntled. And of course, I knew how to put pressure on everybody, and I would tell Van Damage, hey Van, you know what's kind of fucked up? I make 10, and Tom Byron makes 10, and you only make 5, but really you make 10. But Greg Elves takes the other 5. And on top of that, he makes $250,000 a year being the general manager. That's fucked up. And Van Damage went, yeah, that is fucked up. So Van Damage started to put pressure on Greg, saying, it's fucked up that you take that other 5. I should be getting 10, just like Rob and Tommy. I want 10. I want my fucking money. Kind of like Maury from Goodfellas. I want my fucking money. I want my fucking money. Everybody else got their fucking money. I want my fucking money. And Greg Elves started getting very upset at Van Damage. He started getting very upset at me. He started getting very upset at all of us because we were invoking and making the waters very rocky for Greg Elves. So what happened was Greg Elves went out and got a guy named Mike South. And at the time, it was this hillbilly jerk-off like he is now, and he would make this ugly, horrible porn in Georgia where he'd get these fucking herpy-riddled girls that were infested with fucking God knows what, and him and his fucking hillbilly friends would fuck these girls with their fucking AIDS-ridden fucking body. It was just disgusting. And I'll never forget, one of the guys had a herpes sore on their dick, and Van Damage is pointing out, going, look at that herpes sore. Look at that herpes sore. And so, out of the blue, Greg walks in, and at the time, the way our offices were on Cabello Street was an upstairs and a downstairs. And our upstairs housed 4 offices that were open. And in the middle of the office was a giant round conference table. And Greg Alves is on the left corner. I was on the right corner because I was the sales manager then. Patrick Collins was across from us on the left corner. And Nick Wilson, our art guy, plus he owned a company called Dark Side Entertainment, was on the right side. And Greg Alves was sitting there talking to Patrick, and Greg was kind of being quiet with what he was saying, and he's showing Patrick a movie, showing him some product, having a VHS copy. So I, as the sales manager, walk over, what's going on? And Pat goes, wow, Greg's got this new director that he says could be really hot and good. He's from the South. And I go, what are you talking about? And he goes, his name's Mike South, and he shoots these girls from. So right away, I know what's going on, and Greg gives me this look like, ah, fuck. And I go, okay, and he goes, well, Greg's saying that we do so good with Van's amateur stuff that we should bring in another amateur line. So I start looking at the stuff. I go, this is garbage. I go, this is hillbilly garbage, Pat. And he goes, you think? And Greg goes, Rob, what are you talking about? I'm talking to Pat right now. And I said, okay, talk to Pat. And so Greg starts talking to Pat, and as I walk away, I'm looking at Pat going, with my nose, garbage, crap. And Pat starts laughing. Now, you guys got to remember, if you ever look at any of my old Elegant Angel movies and watch the credits at the end, I would call Patrick my father, and I would say dedicated to my surrogate father, Patrick Collins, and I was very close with Pat, very, very close. And so Greg convinces Pat to let Mike South do one movie and bring it in. So he brings the movie in, and we put it out. The box is dog shit. The girls are ugly. And basically, Mike South fucking girls is disgusting. And we know what's going on. And basically, what it was about was Greg trying to create leverage so that Van Damage would shut the fuck up and stop trying to take Greg's $5,000 that he was taking from Van. Now, we'd all become friends with each other, and Van would work in my movies, and he would run camera, or he would fuck in a Tommy movie, or run camera. We all were just together. And Van Damage came into our office and started commiserating. When I say our office, talking to me, talking to Tommy, doing his shtick. And so I told Van Damage, don't worry, this douchebag ain't going to get nowhere in this company. I'm going to talk to Pat. He's gone. We ain't having no hillbilly southern douchebag in our fucking company. And so the movie came in, it went out, and it didn't do fucking better than Van Damage. It did less than Van Damage. And I went to Patrick and I said, Patrick, I told you the guy's shit. I want you to watch this movie. And me and Tom Beyer and Van Damage put the movie on, and we sat there and said, Pat, you want movies where guys have herpes sores? Look at that red blister. And I said, look at that girl. She's got fucking cracked out teeth. Pat, look at this garbage. I go, we're fucking Elegant Angel. We got Comeback Pussy by Tom Byron. You got Rob Black, the fucking master of fuck. I'm the new Greg Dark, motherfucker. I go, you got the best black line in the business called fucking Dark Side. I go, are you fucking kidding? I go, you're Sodomania, Pat. I always played on Pat's ego, man. I go, you're fucking Sodomania, Pat. I go, nothing's bigger than Sodomania. You're the motherfucking godfather of King, Pat. And he goes, yeah, yeah. And I go, Pat, no fucking way are we going to fuck. Come on, Pat. And I would say within an hour, Greg comes up from like lunch or whatever the fuck he was. Or maybe it was the next day. And Pat had no couth. He didn't give a fuck. And Pat just tells Greg, he goes, you know, Brad, me and the boys were watching this Mike Soft crap. I can't believe you'd let me put this up. This is the worst piece of shit in the fucking world. It's going to make Ellen and Angel be embarrassed. Look at this. And you can see Greg's face, literally, just like, and he looks at me. And I give him this, hey, don't fuck with me, motherfucker. I'm the master. And Pat goes, get this shit out of here. And that was it. Mike South was shit canned. And Greg Alves goes, why the fuck did you do that? And I said, because you're trying to fucking edge fucking Van Damage out, man. I go, that's fucked up. I go, you should give him his fucking 10 grand. And ladies and gentlemen, guess what happened? About a month later on the next movie, because we had to make one movie a month, Van Damage got his 10 grand because I also told Patrick that Greg was taking his fucking money. And Pat said, that's not right. That's not right. And at the end of the day, Rob Black, as always, fights for his fucking people. He fights for his fucking crew. And Van Damage wound up getting the $10,000 fucking dollars a movie, and Greg Alves lost his pride and joy, leverage position, Mike South. And Mike South, after that firing, I mean, the guy couldn't even last past. Guys, I could give you a list of losers that were at Elegant Angel that lasted longer than Mike South. Santino Lee, Sex TV, lasted longer than Mike South. Jay Astley lasted longer than Mike South. Mark fucking Wallace, who infected 5 people with HIV, was there longer than Mike South. Mike South got his ass fired. Fired. Gone. Loser. All right? I got his punk ass. He's always been my bitch dog. See this? This is what I used to do to Mike South. Watch. I'd whip him like a fucking bitch dog. And I'd just like this. Come here, bitch dog. You like that, you bitch dog? Take a look at Mike South's career. When you go from Elegant Angel to, as he would put it, in an earlier post, I think a month or two ago, that he wasn't racist because he went out with a girl named Midori, and he would fight to put her on a cover of boxes because the studio guy wouldn't let him. Yeah, who's that studio guy? It wasn't Elegant Angel, because Rob Black got you fired like a bitch dog. You are my dog, bitch. You fucking bitch. So that's what I did. So Mike South didn't like when we recounted that story Friday night on the Rob Black Show.com, and Tom Byron wrote it up for Adult FYI. Mike South didn't like the fact that Rob Black derailed his little bitch career. Because Mike South is a punk. He's not a pornographer. He's never been a pornographer. He's some asshole wannabe from fucking Georgia that's always wanted to be a pornographer, but he could never be. And his one shot, he wasn't successful enough. He didn't have the stature. He didn't have the fucking intestinal fortitude to be a somebody. That new guy, Rob Black, got his ass fired. Look at the annals of fucking porn history, baby. Take a look at the annals of porn history. Mike South is a loser. He lasted one movie at Elegant Angel, and Rob Black got his ass fired. After that, who the fuck knows where this fucking Verdrul went? Literally, I think he went to the lowest, loserest companies in the entire fucking business. Seriously, There, at the time, Elegant Angel was the biggest entity there was going. We were bigger than Evil Angel. Evil Angel had the old guys. Evil Angel had Greg Dark, who had just retired to do music videos. John Leslie was still there kicking ass. And Joey Salvera just started the shemale shit because his movie sucked. Nobody gave a shit about Joey Salvera movies. They were horrible. All of a sudden, him and John Stagliano started fucking trannies, and that reinvented his career. Off of that, you had nothing. Elegant Angel, which was us, we were the biggest motherfuckers at the time. Nobody was bigger than us. We won all the awards. We did everything. And Mike South tried to be a part of that, and Rob Black got his ass fired. So, adult FYI, ladies and gentlemen, we took the hilarious story and talked about Mike South and getting fired because he's a bitch. He's my bitch, and he'll always be my bitch. He's a loser, and unfortunately for him, he will sit there in Georgia and write his little pussy blog where he posts fake names on his comment board. Like, he literally comments as fake people, ladies and gentlemen. He comments as a different person. So he goes under a different name and posts on his comments and will argue with himself to try to show and drum up, a conversation. So this is the funny part, guys. We talk about this loser constantly. And so guess what happens? Sunday, he decides to do a post, and me and Tom Byron were talking about it last night, and what's funny is, it's almost like making fun of somebody that's retarded, because they have no defenses. They can't defend themselves. They literally can't defend themselves. They try to defend themselves, but they can't. It's quite entertaining. So Mike South makes a post about me on Sunday. And the funny thing is, the post he makes, he doesn't address any of the stuff that I said about him. And more importantly, what's funny, he ends it all by saying that Sundays are slow anyways, and that's why he wrote a story. But if you look back in the history of what this idiot's been doing on his site, he doesn't post on the weekends. He doesn't post on the weekends unless somebody is full of AIDS and it's a continuing story. He doesn't post on the weekends. So he actually went out of his way to post about me on Sunday. And the funniest thing is, he has absolutely nothing to say. I talked about this loser. Tom Byron wrote it up so eloquently. And this loser says nothing in response except the same old recycled shit. And on top of that, I wrote him an email after I saw this and sent him a picture of my own shit. And he won't even put it up, this pussy bitch. This is the funny, I'm telling you, it's like making fun of a fucking retard who just doesn't defend themselves. So I'm going to read you this post that this retard wrote. And again, you heard what I just said, and if you go to adultfyi.com, you can read it in a concise aspect where it doesn't have all of the verbiage that I just said. So it's more concise. But here it is. You ready? Rob has been poking at me forever, trying to get a mention. forever. Mike South is part of the news agency, and I poke at him no different than I poke at Alec Helmy. Alec Helmy's a cunt bitch, and AVN's a cunt bitch, and they both are cunt bitches, and Mike South likes to tell everybody that he's the news. He's the important news. So he gets poked at just like all the other news agencies. So he says, his infantile whining is only surpassed by his delusions of grandeur. To hear Rob tell it, he is responsible for every major event that has happened in porn since he came in. Most minor ones, too. Well, again, Mike South, if you can dispute all of the things that I talk about that I'm responsible for, I would be more than all ears to listen. We could go down the list of talent that I'm responsible for creating. We could literally go down a list, which we always do, but I'm waiting for you to dispute it, Mikey. Oh, you don't want to dispute it because you can't dispute it. Already you start off with not even disputing anything. You're nothing. Truth is, the things he's responsible for are mostly scumbag things, like bouncing checks to talent that he never made good on and ruining careers. Okay, like Tom Byron's. It's damn shame that Rob had to drag Tommy down with him. But when you lie down with dogs, you're going to get fleas. And Rob has proven nothing up to be the lowest of curs. So, again, Mike South. As we've always said, ladies and gentlemen, before, that's Mike South's biggest thing. Scumbag things like bouncing checks. The most old, regurgitated. That's like saying Bill Clinton got a blowjob from Monica Lewinsky. Mike South, you ignorant hillbilly, that's all you got? That's it, you faggot? I just talked about getting your ass fired, ruining your fucking career, you bitch, and all you got is bouncing checks on talent that have never made good on? That's it? Listen, Mikey, it's amazing, ruining career. So, Mike, can you answer this Tom Byron ruining of the career? Last time I checked, it was about a year and a half ago that Tom Byron won Best Supporting Actor Award for being Obi-Wan Kenobi in a vivid Star Wars Axel Braun movie. And then was nominated as being Dean Wormer in the Animal House parody. So in the last year and a half, Tom Byron hasn't been acting. Now, if anybody could answer me where the 52-year-old Tom Byron should be acting in the last year and a half, I'd be more than willing to open our ears. Mike South, you want to tell us on that? Once again, the last time I checked, Tom Byron had a company called Tom Byron Pictures that Frank Kretzky fucked him out of, and he controlled and ran a company called Dream Zone Entertainment that Frank Kretzky fucked him on. And while that was going on, Tom Byron edited and acted in all the extreme comics movies, and then starred in Axel Braun's Star Wars movies, where he won Best Supporting Actor. So, Mike South, again, if you're going to say stuff, you need to at least back the stuff up. I'm able to back up everything I say about everybody. Mike South, you look like a retard that you are. When you can't back anything up, it seems pretty amazing that you're not real sure the history of our business, but what do you expect? You're in Georgia. you hang around with a bunch of losers. You hang around with you hang around with a girl named Lindsay Lovehands. That's a porn star. Are you fucking insane? You hang around with Tim Case. I mean, Mike, stop. You hang around with losers. You don't even you hang out with people that work with Scott Sparks. Who the fuck is Scott? I never knew who Scott Sparks. If I didn't know any better, I would think Scott Sparks is paying you to talk shit on him so we all know who he is and we all talk about him. I've never fucking heard of Scott Sparks until you talk about him, which means you actually hang out with people that do business with a bottom-feeding loser. So again, South, can you explain, besides the old story of Rob Black bounced checks to talent, again, hey, South, can we get some new, can we get some new fodder? Can we get some new fodder on that? And can we fucking please tell me that Tom Byron ruined career? I'm still waiting on that. Now, after Tom Byron got his company stolen by Frank Kretzky and Adam Hasner, and all the companies stopped shooting Mike South, would it have been a successful career move for Tom Byron to be in 50-man gangbangs with Jennifer White? No, seriously, because I'm pretty sure Tom Byron, as a 52-year-old man, would love to play out the rest of his legacy in doing 50 fucking man gangbangs. I'm definitely, but I forgot, Mike South, that's something that you would be doing. Actually, that's stuff you do. You do Southern Bukkake. You actually put your old fucking herpy-ridden ass on a fucking camera with a bunch of fucking Georgia hillbillies and shoot a bunch of low-level scabs and call it porn. Well, Mike South, here's the thing. When you've reached the success of Tom Byron, it's kind of like a motherfucker going, you know what? Nobody shoots porn anymore. Vivid doesn't make movies anymore. And Axel Braun isn't really making movies anymore, considering the last movie he made for Wicked as his debut consisted of blow bangs, DPs, you know, all that quality stuff. Now, again, Mike South, if you could figure out where all of these problems are, as far as the structure of what you think Tom Byron should be doing right now as a 52-year-old man, I'd be more than willing to listen. Shit, Tommy in the other room would love to listen. If you could tell him these awesome companies that are shooting that need the work of a 52-year-old man that doesn't involve blow bangs. Tom Byron had to do a scene during his run of the Star Wars thing, and he thought, he told me it was the lowest point of his fucking career when he's doing fucking gonzo scenes for Tim Von Swine for a fucking Mike John release. And he fucking looked at me and went, this is where the business is. I get paid $1,000 to be Obi-Wan Kenobi, and now I'm doing fucking gonzo scenes with AJ Applegate. He goes, what the fuck? He goes, I ain't doing this shit no more. He goes, I ain't doing this no more. He goes, I'll go work at Home Depot before I get my 52-year-old ass fucking sitting there stroking my dick and putting it in some fucking fat-ass girl who fucking, tested fucking positive for fucking gonorrhea a week before, and her medications pretty sure that it's ran its course. Yeah, sure, Mike South. Sorry, buddy, but those of us who've actually been successful in our careers, we don't like to look at doing stuff just for the sake of doing it. I mean, really, Mike South, I know it's hard for you to understand because you've never amounted to anything in your life. You've never amounted to anything successful in your life. And in turn, that is hard for you to swallow, considering that if you were a real rocket scientist and you actually had a real degree, why the fuck would you be shooting bukkake blowbangs with inbred hillbillies from Georgia writing on a porn site? You wouldn't, because you're a fraud, you're a phony, you're a fake, you're a loser. So, again, we here at the ROB BLACK SHOW have no urge to see Tom Byron fucking at the age of 52 in a gonzo movie, or better yet, a 50-man blowback. Sorry, but that doesn't seem to be high on the priority list. But if that's appealing to you, hey, man, more power to you. We could get you the names of the talent and the companies, and if you want to go and, come out to L.A., I'm sure they could throw you in some fucking blowbangs. But the last time we all checked, I mean, do you realize that the last time we did a feature and we were laughing and Tommy was Commissioner Gordon. And I mean, we actually done before or after then, but everybody was making fun of the fact that Brad Armstrong only, and it was Damien, our camera guy, they were making fun of the fact that Brad Armstrong only has two positions he's able to do, which was a spoon and on his back. Because those are the only two positions that didn't show off his big fat gut. And Tom Byron literally looked at Damien and said, "Is that how I am?" And we all started laughing. And Tommy goes, "Jesus Christ." He goes, "Ugh." He goes, "That's what I've always been terrified of, is just being around too long to be the fat old porn guy." He goes, "Man," he goes, "I was like the guy fucking Tracy Lords. And now I'm the guy that's got to take a break because I'm fucking bald as Lex Luthor, fucking Chanel Preston on a fucking table. I got fucking a white suit on." He goes, "And I got to take a break because I feel like I'm going to have a fucking heart attack because I want to be fucking on a bed half asleep right now." And we start laughing. He goes, "Dude," he goes, "you got to get me out of this performing shit." He goes, I don't want to do this shit no more. And we laughed our asses off. Do you realize that the Obi-Wan Kenobi scene that Tom Byron did was something that he did? He didn't even want to do the sex. He goes, "If I could just do the acting, that would be just, that's all I want." He goes, "Fucking at the age of 50 years old on film is fucking pathetic." He goes, "It's fucking pathetic." So, Mike Southey, if you can really rationalize in your own mind that being a 52-year-old man and doing fucking blowbangs is something that somebody can do, more power to you, babe. But in our world where we're actually successful and we were like fucking superstars, that's like being the president of the United States and then going and being the mayor. Okay, jerk off. So if a movie comes along, as Tom Byron would tell Axel and stuff, and say, and literally Tom Byron's already told that, "Axe, if you got a non-sex role, I'll be there for you. But, man, I definitely ain't fucking in no movies no more. Uh-uh." We used to make fun of Ron Jeremy. And Tom Byron would go, I never want to be Ron Jeremy. And I remember when we were working and we were doing the Dream Zone stuff and we were doing the Extreme Comic stuff. And Tom Byron, at one point, we were outside and he goes, I'm fucking Ron Jeremy now. And I'm like, ah, it ain't that bad. You're making money. He goes, yeah, I'm fucking Ron Jeremy. He goes, that's what my life has amounted to. I'm 50 years old now, and I'm fucking in porn. He goes, awesome. He goes, this is great. So, Mike, stop. Again, most successful porn actors, they don't want to be fucking at the age of 50 years old. It's not something they want to do. Sorry, dumb fuck. All right? Sorry, dummy. So, again, if you could justify doing blowbangs, Mike South, God bless you, but you're fucking a loser. And then Mike South continues, Rob is a functional illiterate. Most everyone knows he lacks the capacity to write in any understandable form. Okay? That's Tommy doing the writing on Adult FYI. Okay. And because of his association with Rob, nobody in porn will touch him, and I don't blame him. Okay. Let's see. God, Mike South, you're just pretty funny. Because once again, Tom Byron is writing the stories for Adult FYI. Tom Byron actually wrote an article when he took over the writing duties from Gene Ross, and Tom Byron made a big thing about how he was going to this new phase of his life and that he was going to try to do the job justice that Gene did and that he was excited. So, Mike South, are you... We couldn't figure this out. Are you trying to inform everybody that I don't write the stories and that I've been running around telling people that I write the stories on Adult FYI? I mean, again, Mike, stop. Listen, at least when I come at you and I bust your balls and call you a loser bitch, we back it up. It's like we're trying to figure out what's your concept of Rob lacks the capacity to write in any understandable form. Mikey, again, that concept has never been argued that Tom Byron is doing the writing on Adult FYI. Mike, are you upset that everybody reads Adult FYI? Are you upset that our ratings are higher than yours? I'll make you a deal right now, bitch. Let's see your fucking numbers. I'll show you my numbers, but you won't, you faggot. Even your little fucking, your little Mark friend, your little buddy that writes in the fake name. She even told me our numbers are higher than you, you fucking loser, bitch. More people go to our site, Mike South, every day than you. Sorry, Mikey. You want to look at the Google Analytics? You don't even have it because you don't want to see the real numbers. Come on, Mike. You want to do it? We kick your ass every day in the ratings, you faggot. So, again, Mike, we're trying to figure out with your telling everybody that I lack the capacity to write and that Tom Byron does all the writing. Can you please explain to us when we ever told people that I did the writing? So, I mean, it's just so weird. Like, Mike South, can't you come up with anything fucking pertinent? Mike, I'll give you one better. If you look at the two books that are available for sale on Amazon.com and iBook and Nook and Lulu, if you look at the two books, Extreme Thoughts by Rob Black and Don't Drink the Kool-Aid or Drink the Kool-Aid, Do you realize that both books say written by Tom Byron? Did you know that? Oh, you did know that or you didn't know that? I mean, again, Mike, stop. When you try to say things that are gotcha, like we gotcha, you at least got to have a gotcha. Can you at least come out with a gotcha? Where's the gotcha? Everybody knows that Rob Black lacks the capacity to write any understandable form. That's Tommy doing the writing on Adult FYI. Mike South, again, can you explain to us where the gotcha is? Considering that Tom Byron, in the last, year or last 5 months, has made a pretty good name for himself being a writer. That Tom Byron has now written 2 books, and Tom Byron is in the process of writing the biography of my life. And none of this would have happened if everything would have not been the way it is. From Gene Ross leaving Adult FYI to the business turning to shit, because Tom Byron would never have had, and he'll even admit it, the wherewithal to one day just decide, you know what, I'm just going to write stories. Just like I would never have decided to do wrestling. There's things that happen in our lives that propel us to do things that ultimately put us in different places where we become successful. Right now, Tom Byron is a writer that is pretty fucking good. And the Adult FYI site and our ratings are higher today than they were before Tom Byron was writing. So now if that's any indication into how good Tom Byron is, I don't know what is. If writing 2 books that are hot sellers on the websites right now, and iBook and all that crap, if that's not an indication that Tom Byron is a good writer, I don't really know what is. It's pretty funny. I'm not real sure. I'm not real sure. And you know what? One of my boys, Patrick, you want to know what he just hit me with? Dude, you ain't lying. Watch these 2 scenes with Ron Jeremy. He had to retire after these scenes. Wow, it's embarrassing. It's like an old boxer who stayed around too long, and he's just getting his ass kicked, laugh out loud. Basically, Larry Holmes versus Muhammad Ali. This one, he jerks his dick for 90% of it, and he can't get it up, and then asks the girl to just kiss it. This one clip is the girl is laughing because he can't get his dick hard and just comes out of the blue and the girl's in shock. Laugh out loud. So, yeah, Mike South, Tom Byron wants to be Ron Jeremy and not be a writer. What are you, out of your fucking mind, Mike South? Again, if you could come up with something that is pertinent and entertaining to us and a real gotcha, it would be worth it. But right now, by telling your viewers that Rob Black doesn't write the articles on Adult FYI, which we never ever said that I did, and we've never even hid the fact that, I mean, Mike South, every day when I talk about stories going up, I sit there and say, Tom Byron's working on the story from today. Tom Byron's working on a story from last night. I'll sit there and go, the old fag next door is almost done with the story. He's going to bang on the wall when the story's up. And then Mike's up, you'll hear a bang on the wall, bang, bang, bang. And I go, oh, Tom Byron just told me he just put up the new story. Mike's up, you're a fucking moron, man. I mean, again, if you're going to fucking try to match wits with us, and beat us, you got to at least come up with something, you dumb fuck. You got to at least fucking come up and say something pertinent. Okay? But he doesn't. He doesn't. It's just the same shit.
Tom Byron writes the stories. Rob Black doesn't.
Again, Mike Sapp, we've been on the air now for almost a year. Tom Byron's been writing for about 6 months, or maybe a little less, and everybody that listens to us knows that Tom Byron writes all the stories. Everybody knows that Tom Byron wrote the last two books because it says his name on the books. We've never hidden any of that stuff, you stupid motherfucker. Again, you look like a whining little cunt. And again, what you should be doing is dispelling the rumor that I got you fired. You should be dispelling the rumor, you little bitch dog, that you're a nobody, nothing, that's accomplished absolutely zero in your life. And then Mike goes on, you can add Lizzie Borden and Katie Summers to the list too. Everything Rob gets close to gets fleas. Okay. Okay. So, Mike's listening to this. Again, the guy is a retard because he says,
Rob is a functional literate. Most everyone knows he lacks the capacity of writing any understandable form. That's Tommy doing the writing at Dolph. Why? Because of his association with Rob, nobody in Parm will touch him. I don't blame that. Okay, again, who, what? What are you talking about, Mike Sapp?
As of a year ago, Tom Byron is, well, why are you, you're insane. And it goes to, you could add Lizzie Borden and Katie Summers to the list too. All right, well, Mike Sapp, not for nothing. Again, maybe you're out of the loop, but my soon-to-be ex-wife put out a press release, I think last week, where she notified everybody that she retired from the porn business. She retired from the aspects of this porn world. Why? Because she's got a boyfriend who is a rock musician, and together they've created a line of jewelry and a line of paraphernalia and a whole bunch of shit that doesn't involve her getting fucked in her asshole on film, Mike Sapp. Now, again, we know that you're a loser and we know that you're in your 60s and you still jerk off on girls' faces. But a lot of us, Mike Sapp, that were extremely successful in our careers, don't like to go backwards. Now, unlike other people in the business, I think my ex-wife kind of looked at the landscape of porn, and when she got offers from people like Jim Lane and other people at Devil's Films, and they wanted her to do movies again, and she actually sat there and said, why the fuck would I go from being a director, being the owner of a company, being a wrestling superstar, to now sucking dick on camera again? Yeah, that's a good career choice. That shows that I've progressed in life. Mike Sapp, are you so incredibly retarded? If Lizzie Borden would have got back in porn, that would have been a fucking loser fucking move. Do you get that, Mike Sapp? The fact that my ex-wife is now doing tours of haunted houses in fucking Salem, Massachusetts, and creating fucking jewelry, and creating fucking clothing, and with a fucking rock musician. What are you, fucking nuts, Mike Sapp, you dumb fuck? Yeah, but that's what I sure would want Lizzie Borden to start doing fucking blowbangs for Mike Sapp. Southern Bukkake! Mike Sapp, are you the dumbest motherfucker in the world? My ex-wife isn't Jenna Jameson, who then shows back up in the porn and starts hosting award shows and getting fucked up her asshole, okay, you dumb motherfucker. So, Mikey, maybe you didn't hear about it. Maybe you've been way too long hanging out up in the fucking Georgia mountains, lynching up black people, you racist motherfucker. But my wife don't suck dick no more on camera, fuckhead. Sorry, okay? She walked away from the porn business. Now she's in the music business. Sorry, Mike. Sorry, buddy. And then you move on to Katie Summers. Well, Mike, what you're saying is Katie Summers that would go out with a kid with a red hat who wanted to be a rapper. Katie Summers lived with Aaliyah Janine in an apartment in a half of an apartment on Magnolia Street. She had Chris at Fox Modeling, her agent, and she was doing privates with Brooklyn Lee for an old guy, Victor. So that's successful, Mike Sopp? That's lying with fleas? Or that's not lying with fleas, Mike Sopp? Having Karen from Luxury Companions pick her up and bring her to an escorting gig for Derek Hay and the crew over there, that's successful, Mike Sopp? Again, doing privates with Spiegler girls? That's successful, Mike South? What are you? Are you fucking retarded, Mike South? Seriously, bro. Are you fucking retarded? You've got to be the biggest fucking retard. Living in a rented room in a half of a house with Aaliyah Janine, some 55-year-old MILF. That's successful? Hanging out with Jackie Joy and dating a white kid that's 40 years old wanting to be a rapper? That's successful, Mike South? Wait, are you out of your fucking mind? Doing privates with Spiegler girls is successful? Flying to Texas with LA Direct girls to do privates is successful? Are you out of your fucking mind? Mike Sopp, you've got to be the biggest piece of shit. And this whole fucking statement has nothing to... I mean, you are so out of the loop of what the porn business is. Mike Sopp, you've got to be the big... Do you realize that Katie Summers never even knew what camming was then, you asshole? Do you realize that Katie Summers right now cams with the company that I am associated with, and she gets more money from that company because she gets what is called a studio fee? Meaning this, Mike Sopp, I have friends that are extremely successful, believe it or not, and they do business with Vivid Entertainment, and they rap and make lots of money. Now, they own a cam business. Now, this cam business has studios. And what they do is they give studios to other people. So they go and give a studio to, say, Tom Byron. And then Tom Byron goes and gets his own girls. And then these girls cam. And then that money goes to the main company, and then that main company gives Tom Byron a 10% swing because he's the studio. You see, Mike? So the main company gets half, and then this person gets the other half. And then they kick down 10% to the studio manager. And then that studio manager gives the rest to the girls. That's how the camming world works, Mikey. That's how these people make money. But you see, Katie Summers basically operates as if she's the studio. So she makes 10% more than any other girl in the fucking business camming. Why? Because she lays down with a flea named Rob Black. Sorry, Mike. You need to kind of fucking figure out when you're insulting people to know what the fuck you're talking about. Okay, fuckhead? I'm sorry. I'm sorry that you live in Georgia. I'm sorry that you're a racist. I'm sorry that your mom is also your sister. And I'm sorry that you supposedly have a, let's see, a rocket scientist degree, but yet you don't practice any of those degrees. You jack off on ugly, speeded out crackheads with a bunch of other fucking losers from Georgia. Doesn't make too much sense, but hey, I guess it does in your world. And getting $100 an ad for a banner space is, I guess, worth more than using your master's degree and being a rocket scientist. Again, doesn't make any sense, but that's Mike South. So again, Mikey, what you need to do is just kind of figure out when you're trying to combat me with what you're talking about, because you're talking stupid because you don't know what you're talking about. And everybody else looks at you and goes, wow, Mike, you're pretty stupid. So let's move on from the two women. And Mike, do you realize that these two women, Lizzie Borden and Katie Summers, your little girlfriend and any of the girls you hang out with, they couldn't carry these two girls' fucking pussy blood when they menstruate every month? Do you realize your little friend Lindsay Lovehands couldn't even be the blood that goes out of my ex-wife and my soon-to-be new wife's pussy on a daily basis? Do you fucking realize that, Mike South? And your fucking boyfriend, Tim Case, this old washed-up turd of a wife, she couldn't even be the blood that comes out of these two girls' pussies. Mike South, you don't even fucking associate with a top-name girl that would fucking go out of their way to say that they're friends with you, you fucking loser. You're a fucking nobody. You're a nobody. Vicky Vet? Vicky Vet couldn't be the blood that comes out of these two girls' fucking pussies. Mike Saab, you need to get some fucking better ammunition, you fucking hillbilly faggot. Seriously, bro. Seriously. You really need to fucking, you really need to get something going. And then he says, I had hoped that Rob had matured some, but as it turns out, he's just another Donnie Long. How do you figure that, Mikey? Mature, what are you, my fucking grandfather? You my dad? I had hoped you would have matured. Mike, what are you talking about? You're a fucking douche. I would have hoped that you could use some of your rocket scientists. You're a retard.
Bitter about his failure in the industry that should have succeeded in being born into it and all.
Mike, where's my failure in the industry, you asshole? Again, you have no facts, and you sound stupid. Hey, seriously, bro, you sound stupid. Mike, just the fact that I had a company that was doing $10 million that re-fucking created what porn was in the 90s. I created some of the biggest names. Shit, just take Francesca Leigh and Mark Wood, the big evil angel directors. They came and housed from Extreme Associates, Mike South. What have you done, Mike South? Explain to me, Mike South, what have you done? Seriously. And then he ends with, okay, scumbag, you got your 10 minutes on my site. I'm done with ya. Sundays are slow anyway. Mike, stop. You don't post on the weekends, asshole. You went out of your way to post because I fucking made you look like my fucking bitch again. I made you look like my bitch dog. You're a bitch dog, Mike Sop. So, let's go back to, I'm bitter about my failure in the industry that I should have succeeded in. Mike Sop, again, what are you talking about in the industry? Mike Sop, let's just take Mike Sop. Do you realize that just in the industry alone, if you compare apples to apples, and you compare me to you, I have out-succeeded you 10 to 1. So what are you talking about? If you want to just go by industry accolades, I have won more awards than you've ever had. So if you put me up against you and what I've accomplished against you, what I beat you 10 to 1. Well, I mean, seriously, bro, you look so ignorant. And now, do you want to compare me to Frank Kretzky? Okay. Sure, Frank Kretzky's more successful right now. But aren't we talking about you, Mike South? I mean, since you're the one insulting me, shouldn't you be the one that I'm compared against? And if that's the case, I've out-successed you 10 to 1. The fact that I got your ass fired 17 years ago should say something, you fucking loser. Mike South, do you realize that, I'm perplexed. What Mike South, I am 10 times more successful than you've ever dreamed of. I seriously. Director of the Year, Mike South. Have you ever won Director of the Year? Nah. Have you ever had a movie that's been in the ABN top fucking historic movies of all time? Nah. Best sex comedy? Nah. Best non-sex fucking performance? Nah. Now, Mike, you seem to take all these awards seriously. Shit, Mike. How about this one? Mike, I've got an award, which is the same award that John Stagliano won and that Larry Flint won. So, does that mean that my award is shit, but John Stagliano's award means something? What does that mean? So, I have the same award that was given to me in 06. So, Mike Sop, this same award John Stagliano was given to, and Larry Flint was given to. So, once again, does that mean my award is shit, but their award is good? Or does that mean all of our awards are shit? What does that mean, Mike South? I'm pretty perplexed by all of these failures that I have an award that the great John Stagliano was given to also. I have an award that was given to the great Larry Flint. I have an award that was named after the great Ruben Sturman. So Mike Sop, do you have this? Do you have the same award that your idol John Stagliano and Larry Flint were given? Just that alone, Mike Sop. What are you talking about failure, you asshole? Don't you see how stupid you look? Seriously, bro. Don't you see how ignorant you look? It's perplexing. And the best part is, Mike South, you want to talk about failure? Realize, you stupid motherfucker, that I'm the only person in this entire fucking business. And let me repeat this. Mike South, you fucking inbred, half a fucking retard. I am the only person in this entire business that has a federal obscenity case decision that went in favor of me. I didn't get my case dismissed on a technicality. I didn't get my case dismissed because the prosecutor couldn't play the fucking play button. I didn't get my case dismissed because people were fucking stupid. I am the only person in the fucking obscenity game that actually has a federal judge, Judge Gary Lancaster, who ruled in favor of Extreme Associates and stated that by his court and his definition, obscenity laws, how they applied, were unconstitutional, and that he dismissed my case and wrote a 30 or 40 page decision based on that case. That case is in law books all over the United States, Mike Sal. My case was studied in law fucking groups in different colleges, Mike Sal. My case went all the way up to the third district where Judge Alito and Chief Justice Roberts were part of, where they overturned the decision and remanded it back down to the original judge, Mike Sal. My case was prosecuted by Mary Beth Buchanan, who was at the center of controversy as a lightning rod, who was the only prosecutor left that would not resign when our president, Barack Obama, became president, took office, and all the attorney generals in the United States customarily resigned. Mary Beth Buchanan would not resign until my court case and my sentencing was done. It gained national headlines that that bitch would not resign. She finally resigned after I went to prison. So Mike South, are you insane, you asshole? Are you seriously insane, or does this just prove to everybody that you are a fucking hillbilly from Georgia who's never amounted to anything? Because when you ran your mouth on your bitch website, I was either incarcerated or my motherfucking hands were tied, and I couldn't fucking tell the world what a piece of shit you were. But now that my handcuffs are off, and I can tell everybody what a piece of shit you are, now you are fucking exposed as a punk cunt bitch that's never done anything in this porn business except hide in Atlanta, Georgia, behind a new keyboard and talk shit about stuff you have no clue about. And now you can't stand that I've exposed you for the fucking phony punk dog bitch that you are. That you say things that have no common sense to it. I comp? Again, this punk ass award was given out to me, John Stagliano, and Larry Flint, and Ruben Sturman. Again, Mike Sal, do you have one of these? You don't. You have nothing. You are a loser. Okay, you need to, when you're going to insult me, when you're going to insult Tom Byron, when you're going to insult Lizzie Borden, when you're going to insult Katie Summers, you need to at least have some fucking juice, babe. Come on. You at least need to have some juice, you fucking turd. Can you help me out? Seriously, can you help us out here, Mike? Again, I have an award for a court case that I won. John Stagliano has an award, the same award, for a court case that got dismissed because the prosecutor couldn't push play and record. And Larry Flint never went to jail for pornography. Larry Flint went to jail for the whole DeLoreans and the tapes and all that crap. So, Mike, again, when you use the statement, I'm bitter about my failure in the industry that I should have succeeded in. Again, Mike, I'm not real sure what you're talking about. And then, on top of that, asshole, I own almost 1,000 of my masters that we continue to make money on today. And I own a wrestling company called XPW that have cases and cases of masters that are being put together to be reissued on video on demand. Mike South, what do you have? Again, when you sit here and say statements about people, you need to actually either have it be accurate, or you actually have to have evidence. I mean, something, buddy. Okay? I mean, something, seriously. What, you have nothing. So you say shit that are just lies, and it makes you look ignorant. It makes you look exactly what we've always said you are, which is a lying fraud from the South who knows nothing. And the best part is you made this story and posted it yesterday, which is now today, because remember, yesterday was slow. Well, what's today, Mike? Is today slow too? Why is it slow? You put out a story about Evil Angel and all their violations, and when you go to look for their violations, they're not there. And you come up with the story that there's a mass conspiracy. Ooh, ooh, booga, booga, booga. And all these people are pulling these down. Ooh, booga, booga, booga. Well, after you sounded so retarded and people went, are you fucking serious, moron? Then you posted a story about me yesterday. And it's continued today. So again, Mike, apparently your big conspiracy theory is nothing more than you lying as usual. You're a liar. So for not being busy and having anything to write about yesterday to post a story about me and to keep it up today must mean you ain't busy and you got nothing going on today, bitch boy. So that's 2 days, I guess, you got nothing going on. Wow, Mike, you just keep lying and lying and lying and lying. I mean, seriously, bro, is that all you do is come up with lies? Man, this fucking business should be thanking me for exposing you, Mike South, to what a piece of lying shit you are. And the fact that I'm the only one that keeps your punk ass in check. Because you're a punk dog. You're a fucking phony. You're a fraud. And I expose you every day to the bitch punk dog that you are, motherfucker. A punk bitch dog. Simple. Hey, Mike Sopp, if you go to my website, therobblackshow.com, or you go to adultfyi.com, there's a 90-minute, almost two-hour documentary that is being made about me. What is that? Is that my failures of porn? That documentary has Kurt Vonnegut in it, Bill Maher in it, Larry Flint in it. The list goes on of Orrin Hatch, Senator Brownback, senators. Those are United States senators. Brownback's a governor now. So, Mikey, have you ever had a documentary about you, asshole? Oh, you haven't. I forgot. You're a loser. Again, Mike, if you're going to try to insult me, you need to actually have stuff that makes sense. And when you just blanketly say things that really don't make any sense, you look like a complete loser. Okay, buddy? You look like the inbred hillbilly that you are. You look like a hillbilly loser bitch that you are. Once again, it's pretty simple. Go to adultfyi.com, go to therobblackshow.com, and you could watch a documentary that's in the process of being finished and will be released in theaters. And there's going to be all sorts of new footage. It's going to be fucking awesome. And you could take a look at the rough cut that's on both those sites now. Now, again, Mike, when you talk about never accomplishing anything, you could at least come up with something better.
I wish you would, but you can't. Because if you would have, you could have. And if you could have, you would have. You got nothing. You're a bitch. I've sat here in the last year and put my entire life out there. You're a faggot. You're a phony. You're a fraud. And I expose you every day. The fact that you have people that go on your website and post under anonymous names says exactly what you are, Mike South, a phony, a fraud. The fact that one of your posters that go on your site every day is a Rob Black fan, somebody that I talk to on a regular basis, and they post on your site, you jerk off. They post on your site and they argue with you people every day. And you people think that they're just some outsider, but they're not. They're a fucking Rob Black fan. And I mean, Mike Sopp, you're a loser. You have a message board that consists of literally nobody from the outside world. They're all porn people that hide behind fake names, you fucking phony faggot. Mike, you really need to get some new ammunition. You need to get some new shit, because every day we're going to talk about you. And every day you're going to see your hillbilly ass in big lights. You're going to see your hillbilly ass on the fucking YouTube. You're going to see your hillbilly ass on everything that we do, because you're a fucking phony loser. And that's what we're going to do every day, is keep exposing you. Just like we talk about ABN, just like we talk about XBiz, just like we talk about Frank Kretzky, just like we talk about all of them. And we expose them, because I can tell stories that involve me and all of you, and they're true and accurate. Because I don't give a fuck if it makes me look bad. I don't give a fuck what it does, because that's my life. I don't hide from my life. I don't hide from what I've accomplished, what I've failed at, and what I'm trying to do. That is who I am, and that's what makes me who I am. I am Rob Sicari. And what I've accomplished in this business, you could never fucking fathom, because you have never done anything in your life. Never done anything in your life, Mike Sal, except get fired by Rob Black. Sorry, asshole. Truth hurts, and I know it does, and it will always hurt you. So again, Mike, when you're saying that I've never accomplished anything and I have all these failures, all I got to know is if you respect John Stagliano and his award, and you respect Larry Flint and his award, and you respect Ruben Sturman and his award, then you gotta respect my award, which is the same award that they all got. Bitch. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's the Rob Black Show. It's 3:06 p.m. And we're done today. We've had a great day dissecting not just Mike South, but the business, and cluing you all back in into what we have created, what we exactly set out to do, and why we have done what we've done. We've had an immense joy of putting together this program day in and day out. We have had a great time. We've had a great time creating this show, and we have a great time of taking people and giving them truth and giving them reality and exactly what goes on in this business, in my life, in our lives, and exposing the phonies and the frauds. So we started it with explaining
when we started the show, what the show is about, and where we're going. We started it with exactly everything that is about the show, because I wanted you guys that are new to the program to be in the loop. Like I've said before, I hate being part of something that you don't know what is up, and you're kind of like late to the jokes. And so by cluing everybody in and letting everybody know, we, I think, give an accurate picture of what we set out to do with this program. And then, of course, we segue into letting you all know exactly who Mike South is and the fact that he's retarded and he's comical and he needs to get some better fucking juice and get some better insults because we're going to keep going after him day in and day out. And if any of you want to actually have fun, hit up Mike South and ask him if he's going to post a picture of my shit. I sent him a picture of my shit, ladies and gentlemen. Let me read you the email I sent this faggot. And this is what I sent him. And this just shows you that he's a bitch punk. And this is what I said. You guys ready? You're going to laugh your fucking asses off. It's pretty funny. It really is. It's pretty comical. So, let me get to my email. It's hilarious and it's amusing. Closing time. My fucking phone. So I want to be accurate with what I say. There it is. I sent Mike. Let me show you guys. See, Mike South at Mike South. Just so you know, I'm not bullshitting because, you know, everybody thinks I'm lying. Let me show you guys here. That's Mike South at MikeSouth.com from RZBlack at Yahoo.com. And it says, headline, that's all you got, hillbilly? And I wrote, nothing new, nothing creative. We made this for you that you could post it next to Scott Sparks' picture. Laugh out loud, love, and big kisses. And then look, ladies and gentlemen. Look at that poop. Look at my poop. Look at that fucking poop. What do you think of that fucking poop, man? That's healthy as shit. Look, that's my poop. That's my poop. To Mike South at MikeSouth.com. RZBlack at Yahoo.com. And that was sent to him Sunday at 1:38 p.m. Haven't heard nothing back. I was hoping he would post it in his reader comments, but I guess he doesn't want. So there you go, guys. That's what we do. We send him pictures of our shit, and he doesn't want to post them because he's a punk bitch. That, ladies and gentlemen, is our shit. And this is what we sent to Mike South. But he don't want to talk about it because he's a bitch. And it says, nothing new. See it? Nothing new, nothing creative. We made this for you. You could post it next to Scott Sparks. Love and big kisses. And then there's my poop. There you go, guys. There's my big old poop. See that? But I guess he doesn't want to post that. I guess he's a little bitch-ass punk. We posted that yesterday about 1:30 p.m. So he don't want to post our poop, guys. But hey, we're just going to keep fucking with him
constantly. Because he's a bitch-ass punk. And when you're a bitch-ass punk, that is what happens, being a bitch-ass punk. When you send people bitch-ass punk shit, they don't want to post it because it shows that they're bitch-ass punks. So he's a bitch-ass punk. It's the Rob Black Show. If we had his fucking phone number, we'd call him up on the air like we do. It's like, what's up, bitch-ass punk? But, hey, what can you do? I can only send the guy pictures of my shit. Today, we'll do it. Once I get a nice, healthy shit going, I didn't shit yesterday, and that scares me. But anyways, that's besides the point. Once we get another shit going, we'll take a picture of it, and we'll send it to him. Maybe we'll take a picture, if Katie Summers lets me take a picture of her shit, we'll take a picture of her shit, and we'll send it to Mike Sal. Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, it's the Rob Black Show. We're signing out. And don't forget to go see Katie Summers. She's on stream right now. She's camming. Go watch her, the most popular girl in the history of camming. And go watch her. The things that she does are amazing. Things that she does with her vagina are amazing. And she's great. And she's awesome. And she is a motherfucking warrior. No bullshit. She's a motherfucking warrior. She's a 24-year-old motherfucking warrior. And go watch her. She's the best. And at the end of the day, there is none better. This is the Rob Black Show, and remember, I am responsible for everything in porn, at least from 1996 to now. Woo! Because guess what? You all watch us, you all read us, and you are all part of us every day. So I would say that's everything. It's the Rob Black Show. Go watch Katie Summers, and I'm going to go take a piss right now. And we haven't had any breaks today. You all should be like, wow. And as soon as I finish this vitamin water, we're out of here. So, good day. Good night.